First point. Just as the Qur'an, with all its miracles and truths, indicating its veracity is a miracle of Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, so too, Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, with all his miracles, proofs of prophethood and perfections of knowledge, is a miracle of the Qur'an and a decisive proof of the Qur'an's being the word of God. Second point. The Qur'an, in this world, brought about in so luminous, felicitous, and terrific a fashion, a revolution in the social life of man, as well as in the souls, hearts, spirits, and intellects of man, in their individual, social, and political lives, and having caused this revolution, perpetuated it in such a fashion that for 14 centuries at every moment its 6,666 verses have been read by the tongues of more than 100 million men, training them, refining their souls, and purifying their hearts. To spirits, it has been a means of development and advancement, to intellects and orientation, and light. To life, it has been life itself and felicity. Such a book is of a certain the unparalleled, it's a wonder, a marvel, and a miracle. Third point. The Qur'an, from that age down to the present, has demonstrated such eloquence that it caused the value attached to the earth's known as seven hanging poems that were written in gold on the walls of the Kaaba to descend to such a point that the daughter of Labid, when taking down her father's poem from the Kaaba, said, "Compared with the verses of the Qur'an, this no longer has any value." A Bedouin poet heard these words being recited, "Therefore, expound openly what you are commanded," and immediately prostrated. They asked him, "Have you become a Muslim?" "No," he replied, "I was prostrating before the eloquence of these words." Thousands of scholars and literatures, like geniuses of the science of rhetoric, such as Abdulkahir al-Jurjani, al-Sakkaki, and al-Zamahshari, have unanimously decided that the eloquence of the Qur'an is beyond human capacity and is unattainable. The Qur'an has also from that time forward invited to the fields of combat all arrogant and egoistic literatures and rhetoricians and said to them in a manner calculated to break their arrogance, "Come, produce a single surah like it, or else accept perdition and humiliation in this world and the hereafter." Despite this challenge, the obstinate rhetoricians of that age abandoned the short path of producing a single surah like the Qur'an and instead chose the long path of casting their persons and property into danger. This proves that the short path cannot be taken. Millions of Arabic books are in circulation, some written by friends of the Qur'an in order to resemble and imitate it, others written by its enemies in order to confront and criticize it. Not one of them has been able to attain the level of the Qur'an. Should a common man even listen to them, he is sure to say, "The Qur'an does not resemble these other books, nor is it in the same class as they. It must be either below them or above them." No one, no unbeliever or fool in the world can say that it is below them. Hence, its degree of eloquence is above all of them. Once a man read the verse, "All that is in the heavens and the earth extols and glorifies God," he said, "I cannot see any miraculous eloquence in this verse." He was told, "Go back to that age like the traveler and listen to the verse as recited there." Imagining himself to be there before the revolution of the Quran, he saw that all the beings in the world were living in an unstable, transcendent world, in empty, infinite, and unbounded space, in confusion and darkness, lifeless and without consciousness and purpose. Suddenly, he heard this verse proclaimed by the tongue of the Qur'an, and the verse removed a veil from in front of the universe and illuminated the face of the globe. This pre-eternal speech, this eternal decree, gave instruction to all conscious beings, drawn up in the ranks of succeeding centuries in such fashion that the cosmos became like a vast mosque. All of creation headed by the heavens and the earth was engaged in vital remembrance of God and proclamation of His glory was joyously and contentedly fulfilling its function. All of this our traveler observed. Thus, testing the degree of the eloquence of the Qur'an and comparing the other verses to it by analogy, he understood one of the many thousands of wise reasons for the conquest of half the globe and a fifth of humanity by the eloquent murmuring of the Qur'an, for the uninterrupted continuance of its respected and magnificent monarchy for 14 centuries. Fourth point. The Qur'an has demonstrated such a voracious sweetness that whereas the repetition of even the sweetest thing induces disgust, it has from earliest times been accepted by everyone and even become proverbial that repeated recitation of the Qur'an, far from inducing disgust and weariness in men of sound heart and pure taste, on the contrary increases its sweetness. The Qur'an demonstrates, moreover, such a freshness, youth, and originality that even though it has lived for 14 centuries and passed through many hands, it retains its freshness as if it had only just been revealed. Every century sees the Qur'an enjoying a new youth, as if it were addressing that century in particular. Similarly, scholars of every branch of learning, even though they keep the Qur'an constantly at their side in order to benefit from it and perpetually follow its methods of exposition, see that the Qur'an maintains the originality of its style and manner of explanation. Fifth point. One wing of the Qur'an is in the past and one is in the future, and like its roots and one wing are the agreed truths of the former prophets, and it confirms and corroborates them, and they too confirm it with the tongue of unanimity, so too all the true Sufi paths and ways of sainthood whose fruits like the saints and purified scholars who receive life from the Qur'an show through their vital spiritual progress that their blessed tree is living, effulgent, and the means to truth, and who grow and live under the protection of its second wing, testify that the Qur'an is pure truth and the assembly of truths, and in its comprehensiveness a matchless wonder. Sixth point. The Qur'an's truthfulness and veracity show that its six aspects are luminous. Indeed, the pillars of arguments and proof beneath it, the flashes of the stamp of miraculousness above it, the gifts of happiness in this world and the next before it, its goal, the truths of heaven revelation, the point of support behind it, the ascent and evidence of innumerable upright minds to its right, and the true tranquility, sincere attraction, and submission of sound hearts and clean consciences on its left all prove that the Qur'an is a wondrous, firm, unassailable staple of both the heavens and the earth. So too, from the six levels, the disposer of the universe has set his seal on its being sheer truth and right, and not being man's word, and its containing no error, the disposer who has made it his practice to always exhibit beauty in the universe, protect good and right, and eliminate impostors and liars, has confirmed and set his seal on the Qur'an by giving it the most acceptable, highest, and most dominant place of respect and degree of success in the world. And so too, the one who is the source of Islam and interpreter of the Qur'an is believing in it and holding it in greater respect than everyone else, and being in a sleep-like state when it was revealed, and other words and speeches not resembling or coming near it, and that interpreters describing without hesitation and with complete confidence through the Qur'an through cosmic events of generally the past and the future from behind the veil of the unseen, and no trickery or fault being observed in him while being under the gazes of the sharpest eyes, and his believing and affirming every pronouncement of the Qur'an with all his strength and nothing shaking him, is a stamp confirming that the Qur'an is revealed and true and the blessed words of his own compassionate creator. Also, a fifth of mankind, indeed the greater part of it, being drawn to the Qur'an and bound to it in religion and giving ear to it, eagerly desirous of the truth and according to the testimony of many indications and events and illuminations, the jinn, angels, and spirit beings also gathering around it in truth worshipping fashion like moths whenever it is recited, is a stamp confirming the Quran's acceptance by all beings and that it occupies a most high position. Also, all the classes of mankind, from the most stupid and lowly to the cleverest and most learned, taking their full share of the Quran's instruction and their understanding its most profound truths, and all branches of scholars, like the great interpreters of the greater Sharia in particular, and hundreds of Islamic sciences and branches of knowledge, and the brilliant and exacting scholars of theology, and the principles of religion extracting from the Quran all the needs and answers for their own sciences, is a stamp confirming that the Quran is a source of truth and mine of reality. Also, although the Arab literary figures who were the most advanced in regard to literature, those of them who were not Muslims had the greatest need to dispute the Quran, their avoiding producing the like of only a single surah and its eloquence, eloquence being only one aspect of the seven major aspects of the Quran's miraculousness, as well as the famous orators and brilliant scholars up to the present who have wanted to gain fame through disputing it, being unable to oppose a single aspect of its miraculousness, and their remaining silence in impotence, is a stamp confirming that the Quran is a miracle and beyond the powers of man. Yes, the value, superiority, and eloquence of a speech or word is apparent through knowing from whom it has come and to whom and for what purpose. The Quran then can have no like, and none can reach it. For the Quran is a speech and address of the sustainer of all the worlds and creator of the whole universe, and a dialogue in no way hinting of imitation and artificiality. It is addressed to the one sent in the name of all men, indeed of all beings, the most famous and renowned of mankind, the strength and breadth of whose belief gave rise to mighty Islam and raised its honor to the level of the distance of two bow strings, and returned him as the addressee of the eternally besought one. It describes and explains the matters concerning happiness in this world and the next, the results of the creation of the universe, and the dominical purposes within it. It expounds also the belief of the one it addresses, which was the highest and most extensive of belief, and bear all the truths of Islam. It turns and shows every side of the huge universe like a map, a clock, or a house, and teaches and describes it in the manner of the craftsman who made them. To produce the like of this Quran of miraculous exposition is not possible. The degree of its miraculousness cannot be attained to. Also, thousands of precise and learned scholars of high intelligence have each written commentaries expounding the Quran, some of which are of 30, 40, or even 70 volumes, showing and proving through evidence and argument the innumerable qualities, fine points, characteristics, mysteries, elevated meanings, and numerous indications concerning every sort of hidden and unseen matter in the Quran. And the 130 parts of the Risale-i Nur in particular, each of which proves with decisive arguments one quality, one fine point of the Quran. Each part of it, like the miraculousness of the Quran, and the second station of the 20th word, which deduces many things from the Quran concerning the wonders of civilization, like the railway and the aeroplane and the first ray, called signs of the Quran, which makes known the indications of verses alluding to the Risale-i Nur and electricity, and the 8 short treatises called the 8 symbols, which show how well ordered, full of meaning and mysteries are the words of the Quran, and the small treatise proving in 5 aspects the miraculousness of the verses at the end of Surah Al-Fat in regard to their giving news of the unseen. Each part of the Risale-i Nur shows one truth, one light of the Quran. All these forms a stamp confirming that the Quran has no like, is a miracle and a marvel, and that it is the tongue of the world of the unseen in the manifest world, and word of one all-knowing of the unseen. Thus, due to these qualities and characteristics of the Qur'an indicated above in 6 points, 6 aspects, and 6 levels, its sublime, luminous sovereignty and sacred, mighty rule has continued with perfect splendor, illuminating the faces of the centuries and the face of the earth for 1,300 years. And also, on account of these qualities of the Qur'an, each of its letters has gained the sacred distinction of yielding at least 10 rewards, 10 merits, and 10 eternal fruits, and the letters of certain verses and surahs yielding 100 or 1,000 fruits, or even more, and at blessed times the light, reward, and value of each letter rising from 10 to hundreds. The traveler through the world understood this and said to his heart, "The Qur'an, which is thus miraculous in every respect, through the consensus of its surahs, the agreement of its verses, the accord of its lights and mysteries, and the occurrence of its fruits and works, so testifies with its evidences in the form of proofs to the existence, unity, attributes, and names of a single necessarily existent one, that it is from its testimony that the endless testimony of all the believers has issued forth." Thus, in brief allusion to the instruction in belief and divine unity that the traveler received from the Qur'an, it was said in the 17th degree of the first station, "There is no God but God, the one and unique necessary existent, to whose necessary existence in unity points the Qur'an of miraculous exposition, the book accepted and desired by all species of angel, man, and jinn, whose verses are read each minute of the year with the utmost reverence by hundreds of millions of men whose sacred sovereignty over the regions of the earth and the universe and the phase of time is permanent, whose spiritual and luminous authority has run over half the earth and a fifth of humanity for more than 14 centuries with the utmost splendor. Testimony and proof is also given by the unanimity of its sacred and heavenly surahs, the agreement of its luminous, divine verses, the congruence of its mysteries and lights, the correspondence of its fruits and effects by witnessing and clear vision. Our traveler, our voyager through life, knew now that faith is the most precious capital man can have, for it bestows on indigent man not some transcendent and ephemeral fields or dwelling, but a palace, indeed an eternal kingdom as vast as the whole cosmos or the world itself. Faith also bestows on ephemeral man all he will need for life eternal, delivers from eternal annihilation wretched man who waits on the gallows for the arrival of fate, and opens to man an eternal treasury of everlasting felicity." The traveler then said to himself, "Onward! In order to gain a further degree from among the infinite degrees of faith, let us refer to the totality of the cosmos and listen to what it says. We will then be able to perfect and illuminate the lessons we have received from its components and parts." Looking through the broad and comprehensive telescope he had taken from the Qur'an, he saw the cosmos to be so meaningful and well-ordered that it took on the shape of an embodied book of the Glorious One, an incarnate Dominical Qur'an, a finely adorned palace of the Eternal Besought One, an orderly city of the Most Merciful. All the surahs, verses, and words of that book of the universe, even its very letters, chapters, divisions, pages, and lines, through their constant meaningful effacement and reaffirmation, their wise changes and alternations, gave unanimous expression to the existence and presence of one who has knowledge of all things and power over all things as the author of the book, of a glorious inscriber and a perfect scribe seeing all things in all things and knowing the relationship of all things with all things. So too, all the species and particles of the cosmos, all its inhabitants and contents, all that enters it and leaves it, all the providential changes and the wise processes of rejuvenation that occur in it, that proclaim in unison the existence and unity of an exalted craftsman a peerless maker who sets to work with limitless power and infinite wisdom. The testimony of two great and vast truths of a piece with the immensity of the cosmos affirms this supreme witness of the cosmos. First truth. These are the truths of createdness and contingency established with countless proofs by the gifted scholars of the principles of religion and the science of theology, as well as the sages of Islam. They said that since change and mutation are to be observed in the world and all things, the world must be ephemeral and created, it cannot be uncreated. If it is created, then there must be a maker who created it. And if there is no cause to be found in the essence of a thing, either for its being or for its non-being, so that these two are equally possible, that thing cannot be necessary and eternal. It has further been proven with decisive arguments that it is not possible for things to create each other, since that would involve the absurd and false notion of causality and never-ending causal sequences. Hence, the existence of a necessary existence becomes necessary, whose like cannot exist, whose similitude is impossible, all other than whom is contingent and created by him. Yes, the truth of createdness has permeated the whole of the cosmos, and many instances of it are visible to the eye, the rest can be seen only by the intellect. For in front of our eyes, a whole world dies every atom, and together with it die hundreds of thousands of different kinds of plants and small animals, each member of each species being like a small cosmos unto himself. It is, however, so orderly and disciplined a death that all things leave behind in their places seeds and eggs, that in the spring shall be the means of resurrection and rebirth, miracles of mercy and wisdom, miracles of power and knowledge. They hand to the seeds and eggs their book of deeds and plan of action, entrusting them to the wisdom of the glorious preserver and under his protection, and only then do they die. In spring, the dead trees, roots, and animals come to life again exactly as they were, thus providing hundreds of thousands of examples, specimens, and proofs of the supreme resurrection. In the place of others, plants and animals resembling them exactly are brought into being and life, thus publishing the pages of the beings of the preceding spring together with their deeds and functions, just like an advertisement. Thus, they demonstrate one meaning of the verse, when the pages are spread out. Then, also, with respect to the whole, each autumn a great world dies, and each spring a fresh world comes into being. That death and creation proceed in so orderly a manner, and so many separate deaths and creations occur within them in such orderly and regular fashion, that it is as if the world were a traveler's lodge, where animate beings reside for a time, where traveling worlds and migrant realms come, fulfill their duties, and then go on their way. So, there is apparent to all intellects, with the clarity of the sun, the necessary existence, infinite power, and unending wisdom of a glorious being who creates and brings into being in this world vital realms and purposive universes, with perfect wisdom, knowledge, and equilibrium, with balance, order, and regularity, and who then employs them for dominical purposes, divine aims, and merciful goals, with full power and compassion. We leave to the Risale-i Nur and the books of the theologians the further discussion of matters related to createdness. As for the contingence, it prevails over and surrounds all of the cosmos. For we see that all things, universal or particular, big or small, from God's throne down to the ground, from the atom to the planets, all are sent to the world with a particular essence, a specific form, a distinct identity, particular attributes, wise qualities, and beneficial organs. Now, to bestow on that particular essence and quiddity its peculiarities from amongst the infinite possibilities available, to clothe it in its specific, distinctive, and appropriate form from among the possibilities and probabilities that are as numerous as the forms that may be conceived, to distinguish that being with the identity suited to it from among the possibilities as numerous as the other members of its species, to endow with special, suitable, and beneficial attributes the created object that is formless, and hastened midst the possibilities and probabilities that are as numerous as the varieties of attribute and degree, to affix to that aimless creature, perplexed and distraught amidst the innumerable possibilities and probabilities that result from the infinitude of conceivable paths and modalities, to affix to it wise qualities and beneficial organs, and equip it with them. All of these are indications, proofs, and affirmations to the number of the innumerable possibilities of the necessary existence, infinite power, and unlimited wisdom of the necessary existence who creates, chooses, specifies, and distinguishes the quiddity and identity, the form and shape, the attribute and situation of all contingent beings, whether they be universals or particulars. They indicate, too, that no object and no matter is hidden from him, that nothing is difficult for him, that the greatest task is as easy for him as the smallest, that he can create a spring as easily as a tree, and a tree as easily as a seed. All this, then, pertains to the truth of contingence, and forms one wing of the great testimony borne by the cosmos. Since the testimony of the cosmos, with its two wings and two truths, is fully established and explained in various parts of the Risale-i Nur, and particularly the 22nd and 32nd words, as well as the 20th and 33rd letters, we refer our readers to those writings and cut short an extremely long story.